خاتم الأنبياء والمرسلين صلى الله وسلم وبارك عليه وعلى آله الطيبين الطاهرين وصحابته المباركين الميامين وأتباع بإحسان إلى يوم الدين وسلم تسليما كثيرا. أما بعد، عباد الله، أوصيكم ونفسي الخاطئة بتقوى الله العظيم ولزوم طاعته، كما أحذركم وأحذر نفسي من عصيانه ومخالفة أمره، لقوله عز من قائل: من عمل صالحا فلنفسه ومن أساء فعليها وما ربك بظلام للعبيد. أما بعد، my respected brothers in Islam, we thank the Almighty Allah who gave us this opportunity to gather ourselves in this important occasion. ألا وهو يوم الجمعة، لقاء الجمعة, the meeting, the great meeting of the day of Friday. Now, we want to reflect briefly and simply within a few minutes on the very occasion and the very time that we live in. As we all aware that the whole world, alhamdulillah, the whole Muslim world has witnessed the most important occasion, which is Manasikul Hajji, أو Ziyaratu Baytillahi Al-Haram. We have seen millions, not thousands, not hundreds of thousands, we have seen millions of Muslims, millions of pilgrims, around the world, around the globe, flocking to a very special destination known as Al-Makkatu Al-Mukarramah, the sacred house of Mecca. Now, this khutbah, inshallah, will be an answer of a question that I was asked. What is the logic behind this kind of pilgrimage? Of course, we know that if you ask an ordinary Muslim, any Muslim, why do people go for Hajj? Even a small child can give you the answer. Of course, they do have a specific answer for that, because everyone wants his sins or her sins to be wiped out, to be forgiven. That is a very straightforward answer. But هل للحج حكم وأسرار وفوائد? We ask this kind of question. Apart from forgiving the sins, apart from the sins to be wiped out and forgiven, are there any other benefits of Hajj? Why is it we have to sacrifice our wealth, our time, our health, our efforts? We have to save up for many, many years to go and visit that particular place. What is so special about that Hajj? What is so special about the actual worship itself? And that is going to be the answer for this khutbah. Now, before going to that particular answer, we want first and foremost to reflect on the Quran itself. Because from that particular verse, we get so many answers can be derived, and so many lessons can be depicted from there. The Almighty Allah in Surah Al-Hajj, by the way, we have a complete chapter in Quran known as what? The chapter of pilgrimage, Surah Al-Hajj. And within that kind of chapter, we have one golden verse. The Almighty Allah reminds us when He said, بَعْدَ عَنْ أَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وأذن في الناس بالحج يأتوك رجالا وعلى كل ضامر يأتون من كل فج عميق وأذن في الناس بالحج يأتوك رجالا. محمد, call upon people for pilgrimage, يأتوك رجالا. There will be people, there will be flocking. People will be flocking, people will be coming from different corners of the world. لِيَشْهَدُوا مَنَافِعَ لَهُمْ وَيَذْكُرُوا اسْمَ اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ, so that they could learn and benefit out of that kind of pilgrimage, and so that they could glorify Allah. Here we go. So the Almighty Allah is telling us that this performance of Hajj has tremendous and multiple benefits. What are they? First and foremost, we have mentioned, it is the wiping out of the sins. That is a very general benefit. But apart from that, Hajj, as Muslim, we do embark on this special journey because we want to learn tolerance. Because this journey, for anybody, if you ask anybody who actually went for pilgrimage, even for some of us who haven't been to pilgrimage, the lesson that we depict from that kind of gathering is tolerance and perseverance. What kind of tolerance and perseverance? As a Muslim, me and you, we are taught by the Almighty Allah. Because each and every pillar in Islam and each and every act of worship has lessons to be taught. We are taught as Muslims that we should be the people of tolerance. When you go to pilgrimage, when you go for Hajj, you meet with different kind of people. You meet with different kind of hardship. From the way you organize your transportation, your flight. From the way you have to wait. You have to go to certain countries. You have to meet different people with different kind of behaviors. You have to actually, in tawaf, in circumambulation, you're going to have to actually push yourself, and you have to fight and strive harder to make sure that at least you can complete the actual ritual of worship. That teaches us tolerance. Sometimes, I've got a friend of mine who actually told me, if it wasn't for the Kaaba, we wouldn't have gone there. I said, well, that's very true. Then I asked him why. He said, because the Arabs, those guys, they're so arrogant. I said, what do you mean they're so arrogant? He said, they have no respect to people. I said, well, brother, that is part of the lessons of Hajj. Huh? Because Hajj teaches what? Tolerance. Because, well, not all of us have similar kind of behaviors. So when we go there, or when you watch through the telly, when you see the Muslim brothers and sisters that are chanting, saying, Labbaik Allahumma Labbaik, it's not easy. Labbaik Allahumma La Sharika Laka Labbaik, it's not easy. If you are in that kind of situation, you know how hard it is. And I know some of you have performed the Hajj, so you know the tests and you know the feeling of what I'm talking about. But that teaches you the tolerance as a Muslim. Not only that, we learn unity in diversity. As we all know that pilgrimage or al-Hajj is performed by Muslims of different faces. Different faces. We have Chinese, we have Africans, we have Indians, we have Americans, we have Europeans. You name it. Every single human being, you will find it in Hajj. That is the only worship that is actually for the world. If you're talking about diversity in our culture, in our civilization, we have the most ancient diversity that any other cultures haven't got it. Because if you go to some other religions, you only see certain kind of race. If you scrutinize Judaism, for instance, I'm not going to say all Jewish are derived from certain kind of ethnicity, but the majority will be Jews. Okay, Hinduism, the majority will be Hindus from India or from one particular part of the world. But if you go in Mecca, you'll see this unity in diversity. And they all have one specific type of gown known as al-ihram, the white one. Whether you're president, whether you're a minister, whether you're a tycoon, whether you're a businessman, whether you're a cleaner, whether you're a simple person, whether you just pronounced Islam yesterday, or whether you've been born Muslim, it doesn't matter whatsoever. And here we get the practicality and the application of the ayah, the verse in Surah Al-Hujurat that Allah says, I've created you of male and female, but the best amongst you, not for your color, not for your race, not for anything, but the best amongst you are the people who perform or people who achieve piety. Ya ayyuha an-nas inna khalaqnakum min dhakarin wa untha. These verses to us, they are not theoretical, they are practical. Of course, they are theoretical in Quran, but when you go to places like pilgrimage, like Hajj, you see the practicality and the taste of these verses. Allah said, have created you male and female. وَجَعَلْنَاكُمْ شُعُوبًا وَقَبَائِلَ لِتَعَارَفُوا. And I made you from different nations and tribes and languages and everything. And over there, when you go, you see these kind of things practically. إِنَّ أَكْرَمَكُمْ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ أَتْقَاكُمْ. Over there, it doesn't matter whether you're white or you're brown or you're dark or you're pink or you're yellow. It doesn't matter what the color of your skin. No, أَكْرَمَكُمْ إِنَّ أَكْرَمَكُمْ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ أَتْقَاكُمْ. What is inside, what is in the bottom of your heart, that's what matters to Allah. Allah doesn't like people of certain shape, of certain, you know, outfit. No, Allah like people who come to Him بِقَلْبٍ سَلِيمٍ. Not only that, among the rituals of Al-Hajj, as we know, we have Al-Ihram, we have Qiyam Arafah. For instance, when you see Qiyam Arafah, thousands and millions of Muslims standing at the place called Arafah, what do we learn out of it? First and foremost, that reminds us of the Day of Judgment. Qiyam Arafah actually reminds us and teaches us that we as Muslims, although we are still alive, but the Hajj or the Arafah, the standing itself, reminds us that you could be here, you could be still alive, but you need to remember that one day, one time, you will be going. One day, all time, you will kick the bucket. So that particular standing, the Qiyam Arafah, has an enormous lesson. So you are standing there while you're still on earth, thinking and pondering that one day, one time, I will leave this world. And when I leave this world, when I leave this world, there'll be questions to be answered. And there'll be no help. There'll be no help. And on that particular day, so many sheikhs have talked about, the Quran actually has talked about the Yawm al-Qiyamah, and the things that's going to happen in Yawm al-Qiyamah, that's going to be a very scary day. يَوْمَ يَفِرُّ الْمَرْءُ مِنْ أَخِيهِ وَأُمِّهِ وَأَبِيهِ. Can you imagine? Your fellow brother, your biological brother, your mother that you love, يَوْمَ يَفِرُّ الْمَرْءُ مِنْ أَخِيهِ. Allah the Almighty says, on that particular day, that's why we stand and contemplate and think, that day you will run away from your real biological brother, وَأُمِّهِ وَأَبِيهِ. Even if you are dear, you have your lovely mom, you will have to run away from her, and your lovely dad. وصاحبته وبنيه, even your friends and your children, your lovely children. لكل امرئ منهم يومئذ شأن يغنيه. Why do you think people will be run away from all these kind of companies and people? Wait, because these people, they don't know. شأن يغنيه. Everyone has his own business. He's not sure whether I'm going to be successful or not. That's why you can't even rescue your own child. Now, when we see the Muslims, the millions of Muslims stand for Arafah, we learn and we take this, we depict this kind of immense lessons. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله العظيم لي ولكم فاستغفروه فيا فوز المستغفرين ويا نجاة التائبين. اللهم الحمد لله رب العالمين ولا عاقبة للمتقين ولا عدوان إلا على الظالمين. أحمده تعالى بما هو له أهل من الحمد وأثني عليه وأؤمن به وأتوكل عليه. أما بعد, my respected brothers in Islam, pilgrimage or performing pilgrimage to us is not a tour. It's not a journey that you would want to go and explore the city of Mecca or the city of Medina. No. If you want to go as a tourist, you need to actually look for another time, not the season of Hajj. You could go there as a tourist, there's nothing wrong with that, but for any one of us who actually had an opportunity, that opportunity to go there for pilgrimage, he has to understand that while people are doing the ar-rami, when people are stoning the shaitan, that ritual on its own, whether you go there or you are here, whatever you are, watching through television, that act of ritual teaches me and you that we should be aware of the enemy. So we just don't do that for fun. You see the pilgrims throwing stones thinking, oh, what are they doing? What kind of comedy? What kind of drama these people are trying to perform? That's not a drama. That's not a drama. That's it. That's an actual life. Allah has actually put that ritual to us to know when we come back, or for some of us who haven't got the access, to know that we have an enemy who's always by our side. Who's always by our side. And that's why when we go there, we cast him and we throw what? We throw stones, ar-rami. Okay? And that enemy actually has taken what? A promise. This is what he's qualified for. Huh? We have people who are qualified in different kind of professions. But Iblis or Shaytan, he is fully qualified. He's got more than PhD. He's a professor in misguiding me and you. He's a professor. He authors books. Huh? He has channels. Huh? He has different companies. He has million and multiple companies. This is known as Professor Iblis. He's very competent in his field. Now the Almighty Allah put that ritual there for me and you to know that, oh, this enemy is not asleep, and he will never be asleep. الَّذِي يُوَسْوِسُ فِي صُدُورِ النَّاسِ مِنَ الْجِنَّةِ وَالنَّاسِ. In a very short surah we always recite. Huh? He always here. He's waiting for you to mess about. If you just give him a signal, he will attack you. That is the role of what? Shaitan. Not only that, he made a promise that he will misguide us. And during that particular day, he will stay away from us. And actually, he will blame me and you. And he will say, فَلَا تَلُومُونِي وَلُومُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ. These verses are plenty in Quran. Don't blame me today, but blame yourselves. مَا أَنَا بِمُصْرِخِكُمْ وَمَا أَنْتُمْ بِمُصْرِخِي. I cannot help you, I cannot assist you, and neither you can help me. So we can't help each other today. Don't. So we shouldn't actually come up with this kind of statement, oh, I did it because of shaitan. You know, it was shaitan. No, shaitan here is confessing that he doesn't want to take blame. He doesn't want to take any blame. So we shouldn't do anything and blame shaitan. It was shaitan, you see, brother. That wasn't me. Who was that? Who committed that atrocity? No, it wasn't me. It was shaitan. No, it was you. It was the other version of you, shaitanic version of you who did that. Don't blame Iblis, because Iblis is saying he's going to be far away. So here comes a very magnificent lesson. Not only that, my respected brothers, I know the time is against us. Slaughtering of animals when we go there, and actually some people have been attacking Islam, saying, you people are so barbaric. These people are so cruel. Huh? You're so cruel to animals. Why you keep on slaughtering these animals during this kind of season? Hajj, we see, you know, sheep are being slaughtered just like that. Why? You're gonna kill this species will disappear. Say, no, we do that for sacrifice. As a Muslim, we know the story behind that, why the slaughtering of animals has been prescribed. We know that. It was because of what? Sayyidina Ibrahim's story. We don't want to narrate the whole story here. Huh? But the Almighty Allah say, وَفَدَيْنَاهُ بِذِبْحٍ عَظِيمٍ. And then we compensated Ibrahim alayhi salam بِذِبْحٍ عَظِيمٍ for the slaughtering of that ram that he slaughtered. And that became what? Sunnah for us to slaughter. Why? There is a lesson. Allah doesn't want our meat. Does Allah want our meat and our blood? No, Surah Al-Hajj, the same chapter, Allah says, لَنْ يَنَالَ اللَّهُ لُحُومُهَا وَلَا دِمَاؤُهَا وَلَكِنْ يَنَالُهُ التَّقْوَى مِنْكُمْ. Allah doesn't want your meat. Allah doesn't want your blood. Allah doesn't want your sacrificial blood, because other religions do that. We've seen the Buddhists, we've seen the Hindus, they slaughter cows and then they just let, you know, the animals run. And but by doing that, the blood is just, you know, for them it's fun, for them it's acts of worship. Allah doesn't want the blood. Allah doesn't want the meat. وَلَكِنْ يَنَالُهُ التَّقْوَى مِنْكُمْ. But Allah wants piety, which is coming out of it. What kind of piety which is coming out of slaughtering an animal? Huh? You slaughter an animal and then there will be a piety. Yes, the piety will be that you put yourself, me and you put ourselves into a situation whereby we should be ready. We should be ready to do anything. We should be ready to sacrifice anything and anybody for the sake of Allah. That is the piety which is meant there. That is the piety which is meant there. Not only that, in the whole performance of Hajj, we as Muslims, also we learn تعود المسلم إلى حسن الأخلاق والتعامل وهي فرصة عظيمة للتعرف على الثقافات الأخرى والتعرف على بلدان مختلفة. You see, you find a Muslim, it's really strange, it is very strange. Even some people, some fellow Muslim can ask you, which part of the world you come from? You say, I'm a Muslim from Africa. And they're surprised that even there are Muslims in Africa. These people haven't learned anything from the lesson of Hajj. Nothing. They haven't learned anything. Perhaps they don't even watch television. Because if they actually learned something about Hajj, they would have known that in Africa, in Asia, in America, in Australia, in Antarctic, in whatever the continent is, there will be Muslims. So when you see someone looks a little bit funny, or maybe someone who is against your culture, don't ask him, when did you convert to Islam? No, it shouldn't be a stranger. You should know, me and you should know, a Muslim can be someone from anywhere. That's the lesson, because when we go for pilgrimage, or when we watch that act, we see different faces around the globe. That's what we do. And that is the actual meaning of Islam. Islam is not a religion of a particular ethnicity or a particular race. It's not a religion of Arabs. I totally disagree with that. And some of Arab friends, they actually ask me, brother, you speak Arabic. Oh, so how come you speak Arabic? I say, what a silly question is that? What a silly question to ask me. And I was really furious. I was angry. Oh, so you think this Arabic belongs to you because you're an Arab? You're a silly man. This is a universal language. This is a language for all Muslims. So we shouldn't say, oh, this language is only for Arabs. No, this language is for all Muslims. May Allah give us and grant us the tawfiq to learn and take lessons from the whole act of pilgrimage. هَذَا وَصَلُّوا وَسَلِّمُوا عَلَىٰ إِمَامِ الْمُرْسَلِينَ وَقَائِدِ الْغُرِّ الْمُحَجَّلِينَ فَقَدْ أَمَرَكُمُ اللَّهُ بِالصَّلَاةِ وَالسَّلَامِ عَلَيْهِ فِي مُحْكَمِ كِتَابِهِ حَيْثُ قَالَ عَزَّ قَائِلًا عَلِيمًا إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم، وبارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم في العالمين، إنك حميد مجيد. وارض اللهم عن خلفائه الراشدين، وعن أزواجه أمهات المؤمنين، وعن سائر الصحابة أجمعين، وعنا معهم برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. اللهم انصر الإسلام والمسلمين، اللهم انصر الإسلام والمسلمين، اللهم انصرهم على أعدائك وأعداء الدين برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. عباد الله، إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون. فاذكروا الله العظيم يذكركم، واشكروه على نعمه يزدكم، ولذكر الله أكبر. والله أعلم بما تصنعون. وأقم الصلاة.